On the 6th of August, 1945, the American B-29 Super Fortress Enola Gay took off on a mission that would change the course of history. In the bomber's hold, a weapon with an unprecedented capacity for mass destruction. At 08:15 hours, this revolutionary device was released over the Japanese city of Hiroshima. Seconds later, 80,000 citizens were dead, and the age of the atomic bomb had begun. In Washington, President Harry Truman ordered the Japanese Empire to surrender. Failure to do so would mean a rain of ruin on the Japanese islands. 3 days later, a second atomic weapon destroyed the city of Nagasaki, and the Empire's leadership finally accepted the inevitable. In popular belief, it was this second nuclear attack that finally defeated the might of Imperial Japan and brought with it the end of the Second World War itself. But this analysis is only partially true. On the same day as the Nagasaki bombing, another momentous military attack was unleashed against Japanese forces. It would be one of the largest, most imaginative, and most successful campaigns of the war, but it would also become one of the least familiar to future generations. For many students of the Second World War, the Soviet Manchuria campaign is almost a footnote in the story of the conflict. The whole operation is widely seen as an exercise in simple opportunism, Stalin securing as much booty as he could before American atomic weaponry forced the end of hostilities. But this is an opinion that does no justice to Soviet intentions. In fact, the Soviet Manchuria campaign was a long-planned operation. Stalin's own Western allies had argued for such an offensive for years. Preparations for the attack were painstaking. Campaign strategy was bold and ambitious. The leadership was the best available, and resources were substantial. On the 9th of August 1945, a total of 1.5 million Soviet troops prepared to take part in the Manchuria offensive, a vast undertaking with its origins in the earliest years of the 20th century. In May 1905, the cozy security of the great European powers was disturbed by remarkable news from the far eastern seas of Asia. The Russian Baltic fleet had been wiped out by the warships of Japan. The Russo-Japanese War was over, and it was the land of the rising sun that had triumphed. For Tsarist Russia, it was a national humiliation, and the whole of the Western world now faced the reality of a new power in the East. Just two generations after emerging from centuries of isolation, Japan had become a nation of the industrial age. Victory over Russia secured her status as the dominant power of the Far East. In the years that followed, this regional dominance was maintained. After the First World War, Japan was given control of former German Pacific colonies such as Truk Lagoon in Micronesia. Significantly, she was also allowed to maintain an army in the northeastern Chinese province of Manchuria. This was the so-called Kwantung Army, a force whose official task was to guard the strategically important southern Manchurian railway. But by the early 1930s, the Kwantung Army leadership began to consider a more aggressive role.
These pictures are from a confiscated Japanese motion picture made 5 years before Pearl Harbor. The picture shows how officers who are now fighting us were trained at Japan's West Point, Chikuan Gakko. To this Tokyo school every year come the cream of Japanese youth, about 2,000 students. Each has received training from the day he first walked. At the age of 14, the toughest and healthiest are selected. The survivors take special exams. Perhaps 59 flunk. One passes. He goes on to a junior military academy, and after 2 summers, he moves to the final phase. The first day at Japan's West Point. The CO is welcoming them. "We congratulate you," he says. "We will train your body and your mind. You will work 17 hours a day, 7 days a week. Nothing must distract you from your mission. Remember the words of your first emperor. We shall spread ourselves all over the world. We shall make the whole world our dominion. For men with a destiny, day begins at the break of dawn. Later in the day, there are more practical exercises.
In September 1931, an incident of alleged sabotage on the railway line near Mukden led to the Kwantung Army occupying the whole of Manchuria. Despite opposition from Tokyo, the Kwantung established the state of Manchukuo under the leadership of the last of the old Chinese emperors, Henry Pu Li, or Husan Tung, as he became known. Manchukuo was nothing more than a puppet state, despite the efforts of Japanese propaganda to portray the territory as an independent land of freedom and happiness. The truth was that many Japanese leaders were now keen on the idea of an expanding Japanese empire, and it was their view that came to dominate policy.
The League of Nations sent a committee of five, headed by Lord Lytton and including our own General Frank McCoy, to Manchuria to investigate. In October of 1932, the committee issued its report.
We found that the Japanese occupation of this large part of China was not justified on the ground of self-defense, and that the new state which had been set up was a Japanese protectorate rather than a genuine case of Manchurian self-determination.
Shortly after, the League condemned Japan as an aggressor nation.
À son excellence, Monsieur Mathieu Oka, délégué du Japon. I call on His Excellency, Monsieur Mathieu Oka, delegate of Japan. It is a matter of common knowledge that Japan's policy is fundamentally inspired by a genuine desire to guarantee peace in the Far East and to contribute to the maintenance of peace throughout the world. Japan, however, finds it impossible to accept the report adopted by the Assembly.
In answer, the Japanese delegates, knowing there were no guns behind this condemnation, smiled, took up their briefcases, marched out of the League. Northern Manchuria was dead. Collective security was dead. A green light had been given to the aggressors. We and the rest of the world knew that these aggressors should be stopped and punished, but we were unwilling to make the necessary sacrifices to back up that opinion. It was impossible to convince a farm boy in Iowa, or a driver of a London bus, or a waiter in a Paris cafe that he should go to war because of a mud hut in Manchuria.
In 1937, an incident on the Marco Polo Bridge near the Chinese capital of Peking led to armed conflict between the forces of China and Japan. This was the beginning of the Sino-Japanese War, and millions of lives would be lost in the 8 years of bloody conflict that followed.
And to understand China, three facts must never be forgotten. China is history. China is land. China is people. China is now our fighting ally, or more accurately, we are China's. For China has been fighting our enemy, Japan, for 7 long years. Why is this? Why have the Chinese, who in all their 4,000 years of history have never waged an aggressive war, been forced to fight and die by the millions? China was to be the giant back on which Japan would ride to world conquest. Japan was a united, well-knit, highly regimented military dictatorship. Their aim, the absorption of China and the fulfillment of the Tanaka Memorial.
In Moscow, the leadership of the Soviet Union kept in touch with developments to the south of far eastern Russia. As a bulwark against further Japanese expansion, Stalin made sure that his border with Japanese Manchuria was well defended. It was a wise precaution. In July 1938, a border dispute at Lake Kasan led to hostilities between Imperial Japan and the Soviet Union. It was no small skirmish. Artillery, tanks, and support aircraft were deployed by both sides, but it was the Soviets who emerged victorious. The following year, tension between the two nations resulted in another border conflict at the Outer Mongolian River of Khalkhin Gol. Again, the result was a victory for Stalin, in what proved to be a substantial engagement, lasting from May until August 1939. No fewer than 50,000 Japanese were listed as casualties. In the days that followed, Soviet commanders negotiated a truce with their Japanese counterparts. But regional tension remained, and it was an uneasy peace that now endured along the Manchurian-Soviet border. And the intentions of the Japanese remained a concern amongst the leadership of the Soviet Union, a leadership that was dominated by Joseph Stalin. In the course of human history, there have been few political leaders as ruthless as Joseph Stalin. A Georgian peasant by birth, Stalin became leader of the Soviet Union in 1924 and remained in power until his death in 1953. Stalin's power was absolute within his borders, as his national cult of personality confirmed. To Stalin, terror and violence were legitimate political tools. In the 1930s, millions of Soviet citizens paid the ultimate price as their leader unleashed bloody purges of anyone suspected of opposition to his rule. Many of the Soviet Union's finest military men were amongst those who perished. Stalin's ruthlessness applied equally in foreign affairs. In 1939, he stunned the world by authorizing the notorious non-aggression pact with Hitler's Germany. This act of political expediency went against everything Stalin believed in, but it achieved the result that he wanted. When the Nazis unleashed the Blitzkrieg in 1939 and 1940, the Soviet Union stayed on the sidelines, giving Stalin valuable time to prepare for any conflict that lay ahead. The Soviet leader also made a similar deal in the East. By early 1941, Stalin was increasingly concerned by the potential threat from Imperial Japan. So in April that year, the Soviet leader authorized another non-aggression pact, this time with the dominant power of the East. The Soviet Union was now formally at peace with both Japan and Nazi Germany, and Stalin was succeeding in keeping his country out of the Second World War. But it would not be for long. On June the 22nd, 1941, the greatest land invasion in history was unleashed by Hitler against the Soviet Union. The start of Operation Barbarossa meant the end of the 1939 non-aggression pact, as the Wehrmacht swept across Soviet territory in three huge army groups. It was the beginning of one of the bloodiest conflicts in human history. And it was this epic war that secured Stalin's place in history as a great military leader. Stalin allowed nothing to distract him from his objective of defeating Hitler. And there can be no doubt that the Soviet leader proved an inspiration to his people as they eventually turned back the German advance. Cleverly, he played down the importance of communist ideology as his people began to win epic victories at Stalingrad, Kursk, and other great battles. This was the Great Patriotic War, and Stalin's appeal to nationalist sentiment played a huge part in his eventual triumph. At Tehran in November 1943, Roosevelt and Churchill tried to persuade him to open a second front against Japan in the East, but Stalin refused to consider the idea. Only when Germany was on the point of defeat in April 1945 did he agree to strike against the East. As Soviet troops entered Berlin, Stalin ordered preparations to begin for an attack against Manchuria. Soon, the Soviet leader would pit himself against his counterparts in Japan. For many people today, the figure most associated with Japanese Second World War leadership is General Hideki Tojo, who became his country's prime minister in October 1941. A powerful advocate of Japanese military expansionism, it was Tojo who authorized the attack on Pearl Harbor, and it was Tojo who became the only wartime premier to be executed by the Allies when hostilities ended. But Tojo was no longer in charge when the Soviet Union began preparations for the attack on Manchuria in 1945. In June the previous year, following Japanese defeat at the Battle of the Marianas, he was forced to resign in favor of Lieutenant General Kumiaki Koizo, a weak leader who himself did not survive in power for long. In April 1945, Koizo was replaced by Kentaro Suzuki, a 77-year-old admiral whose military experience stretched back to the 19th century. He had fought in the war between Japan and Russia in 1904 and 5, and he had succeeded in remaining close to the center of power as the Second World War unfolded. But even as prime minister, Suzuki did not enjoy anything like the power of the leader of the Soviet Union. He was certainly not his nation's head of state. That title belonged to the hereditary emperor, Hirohito, the ultimate Japanese leader. Hirohito had the status of a god amongst his people, and he was theoretically above the business of day-to-day politics. But we know that the emperor took a great interest in the progress of the war. The extent to which he influenced policy remains a matter of debate today, but there can be no doubt that as a symbol of Japan, the divine emperor was a powerful inspiration for his armed forces. The loyalty of the Japanese soldier to the emperor bordered on the fanatical. Death in battle was a joyous expression of that loyalty, and the imperial cult contributed much to the sheer ferocity with which the Japanese went about the business of war. It is significant that the Soviet Union remained fearful of this fighting spirit.
But the favorite exercise is bending their backs each morning to Hirohito's holy palace. It develops the spine. In the classroom, there is absolutely no instruction in international relations nor economics. Yet the men who are graduated helped rule Japan. Their lack of knowledge about other countries, about the qualities of other people, about production, causes them to take wild gambles. But on other subjects, they are very thorough. Trigonometry, chemistry, history. There is a great emphasis on languages. German as an Axis partner, English, they once hoped to use it in California, and Russian. A favorite cultural pastime is kendo. Being pounded on the head is supposed to make a man alert. There are other outdoor studies, signal practice, surveying. And this class in yelling, to prepare a man for giving commands and to try scaring the hell out of the enemy. Eventually, every Japanese officer candidate must specialize. Many go into cavalry school. Others go into the armored forces. The engineers, whose instructors have spent years rigging bridges in China. A popular course at Japan's West Point is the artillery. But the most glamorous branch of them all is the Imperial Air Forces. Bombardiers have their own private workout over a moving map. Later it was Chungking. Pilots get into the air very early in their training. Later these men will prepare to die for their emperor in Zeros and Nakajima bombers. All officer candidates are taken on a tactical tour. This jaunt is to a historic battlefield in Manchuria. The instructor tells his men that here their grandfathers, 40 years before, smashed the Russians and vaulted Japan into the big leagues. Holy ground for the Japs, because here was a bloody stepping stone on the divine mission to world conquest. A tactical tour is supposed to give men a smattering of strategy, but for these men it is something more. is a patriotic hypo, injecting a wild passion for Japan. Yeah! That is the real purpose of the tactical tour. Returning to school, the officer candidates have only one more hurdle, final field maneuvers. Here in his last test, the officer unwittingly reveals his major weakness. But while it proves he has stamina and skill, it also proves he has more fanaticism than common sense. He is told that leading his platoon into battle, yelling and waving his sword, he is worth 20 rifles. He isn't told he's also a dead duck. Yes, the Japanese officer seems even anxious to die wastefully. Finally, the big day at Chukwan Gakko. The Emperor God himself is on hand. A thrilling moment for the Japanese officer, but only a beginning. He must spend 8 months in the ranks before becoming a lieutenant. His highest base pay will be the equivalent of $21 a month. He must buy his own uniforms and go into debt purchasing a samurai sword. He may take a wife from the special school for army brides. The honor student of the class receives a special scroll and later will be given a silver watch by the Emperor God. Silver instead of gold to teach frugality and living. And for preparing his students so well, the CO receives a special gift from Hirohito. Yes, this is a big day. And every graduate dreams that his training will lead him to one end, world domination for Japan. But it's being proven otherwise in the stream of ashes being returned to Tokyo.
By April 1945, Stalin had decided that an invasion of Manchuria was a worthwhile objective. It was hoped that it would finally bring the Second World War to an end. There was also the potential prize of a vast new sphere of influence in the Northwest Pacific. But there was one obvious difficulty in preparing for the operation. The best Soviet forces were thousands of miles away in Europe, having beaten the Nazis in their great patriotic war. To relocate them to an entirely new theater of operations would be a huge logistical undertaking. But the Soviet planners were equal to the challenge. All through the summer of 1945, the enormous task of transporting hundreds of thousands of troops took place within the vast territory of the Soviet Union. And this preparation can be seen as the first evidence of the brilliance that would characterize the whole Manchuria offensive. The Trans-Siberian Railway became the focus for the mass movement of men and material. A total of 136,000 railway wagons were deployed in support of this huge relocation. Amazingly, the scale of the operation was kept secret from the Japanese. Much of the movement of military traffic took place at night. Both men and hardware were disguised, and their final destinations were often well away from the vision of Japanese border patrols. The way that these resources were deployed also revealed the confident ambition of the Soviet military. With so much experience of war from the fight with Germany, Soviet strategists were able to allocate their forces according to their own experience. The elite 6th Guard Tanks Army had proved itself in the mountainous Carpathian region of the Balkans. In the conflict to come, this army would fight in the similar conditions of the Manchurian Grand Hingan Mountains. This was just one example of tailoring resources to the specific requirements of the task in hand, and it would be a huge task. To carry it out, Stalin appointed some of the Soviet Union's most battle-hardened commanders. On the 30th of July, 1945, with the relocation of resources almost complete, a new Far East Command was established to oversee the Manchurian offensive. In overall charge, Marshal Alexander Vasilyevsky. Vasilyevsky was a 50-year-old officer who had proved himself in the bloodiest of all battles that took place on the Eastern Front. Having risen through the ranks to become chief of the Soviet General Staff in 1942, it was Vasilyevsky who had masterminded the Soviet offensive at the Battle of Stalingrad, an offensive that contributed so much to the catastrophic German defeat. An idea of the regard with which he was held by Stalin can be gained from events that took place in February 1945. When Stalin attended the so-called Big Three conference at Yalta in the Russian Crimea, it was Alexander Vasilyevsky who took charge in Moscow. In August 1945, he would be given another massive responsibility. Under the leadership structure established for the campaign, Vasilyevsky was given a high degree of autonomy over operational matters. And the marshal was able to allocate his land, sea, and air forces without undue interference from Moscow. To assist him in his task were three more veteran Soviet commanders with responsibility for the vast army groups, or fronts, that would execute the Manchurian invasion. In command of the Trans-Baikal Front was Marshal Rodion Malinovsky, another veteran of the epic Battle of Stalingrad. In 1944, he took charge of the second Ukrainian front that carried out the invasion of Romania, and in April 1945, it was men under his command who secured the conquest of Slovakia. The commanders of the other two fronts possessed a similar level of battle experience. General Maxim Perkaev, in charge of the second Far Eastern Front, and Marshal Kirill Maretskov, in command of the first Far Eastern Front. Although Maretskov did not enjoy the excellent relationship with Stalin possessed by his superior Vasilyevsky, he was still a vastly experienced officer who had made a name for himself during the unfortunate Russo-Finnish War in the winter of 1939-40. Despite having been overlooked in favor of other commanders in the course of the war, most notably the legendary Georgi Zhukov, by early August 1945, Kirill Maretskov found himself at the heart of the action, in charge of an enormous body of men and material on the borders of Manchuria. But he knew that he needed the resources. Within Manchuria, the million-strong Kwantung Army awaited, under the leadership of Yamada Otozo. In essence, the Soviet strategy for the Manchuria campaign can be readily understood. It was a vast pincer movement involving whole armies of troops and material. From the west, the first Transbaikal Front would sweep into Manchurian territory, across the desert, over the mountains, and down into the strategical vital valley plains in the region around Mukden. To assist their advance, Marshal Vasilyevsky arranged for a diversionary attack by 36th Army in the far northwest. This was where Japanese planners expected any invasion to come from, and their regional defenses were accordingly strong. When battle was eventually joined, the 35th Army would be involved in some of the fiercest fighting of the campaign as they pursued their objective of cutting off Japanese troops in northern Manchuria, a task that also involved the men of the second Far Eastern Front, attacking from the northeast. But the real Soviet firepower was concentrated further south. As the main body of the Transbaikal Front headed for the central plains from the Grand Hingian Mountains, so the first Far Eastern Front would complete the pincer movement from the opposite side, with the 25th Combined Army heading southwest towards Korea, and the remaining four armies attacking west from a narrow area of front in the region of Lake Hanka. Their initial objectives, the Japanese military headquarters of Mutanchiang and Yenho. This was a simple strategy, and it had a good chance of proving effective. But the Soviet commanders knew that the Japanese occupying army were only too aware of the possibility of a Soviet attack, and would have made plans accordingly. It is not surprising that in 1945, the Japanese leadership in Manchuria were thinking only in terms of a defensive response, if and when a Soviet attack came. As late as September 1944, Japanese strategy was still informed by a commitment to offensive warfare. But as the tide of the Pacific War turned, a more pragmatic approach was adopted. By June 1945, the Japanese had established their own Manchurian strategy along these lines. Their intention was to engage the Soviet forces immediately, before withdrawing into the Valley Plains region in the south, whilst continuing to harry the enemy at every opportunity. It was hoped that these delaying tactics would combine with the difficulties of Manchurian geography to reduce the effectiveness of the Soviet force. By the time battle was joined on the plains, the Japanese would be in a position to take the fight back to the invaders. It was a realistic strategy, and the Japanese Kwantung Army was theoretically large enough to carry it out. But what they didn't know was the sheer size of the Soviet force that would sweep over the Manchurian border towards their positions. By early August 1945, the Soviet invasion force had moved into position, ready for the coming assault. To the west, the Trans-Baikal Front under the command of Malinovsky. His responsibility, some 2,300 kilometers of front line. To the north, the 36th Combined Arms Army. Further south, four more armies, including the elite 6th Tank Guards. Furthest south of all, a combined Soviet-Mongolian cavalry mechanized group. With air support and reserves, Malinovsky was in charge of some 654,000 men. On the opposite side of the theater of operations, Marshal Moretzkov took command of the 1st Far Eastern Front, a force that comprised a further four combined arms armies. With reserves, air support, and attached independent units, a total of 587,000 men were positioned across a front 700 kilometers in length. The Soviet deployment was completed by the 2nd Far Eastern Front in the north, consisting of a further three armies, again backed up by independent units and air support. Commanded by General Maxim Perkaev, the 2nd Far Eastern Front added a further 337,000 men under arms. In all, the Soviet Far East Command was responsible for a total of 1,600,000 troops, equipped with a massive quantity of material. This included some of the best-known weapons of the whole Second World War. In virtually every theater of operations, the tank proved itself to be an indispensable element of ground warfare. On the Eastern Front, the power of the tank was seen especially at the Battle of Kursk, when it was Soviet armor that eventually prevailed. When the time came to prepare for the Manchuria offensive, the Soviets understandably kept faith with the tank as an offensive weapon. No fewer than 5,500 machines were available to Vasilyevsky's attack force, an armor provision dominated by the most famous model of all, the T-34. This was the weapon that had stunned the Germans in 1941, and by 1945, the five-man T-34 was still an awesome weapon of war. 5.92 meters long and 3 meters wide, the T-34 was powered by a 500 horsepower diesel engine, generating a top speed of some 55 kilometers an hour. Its sloping armor was only 45 millimeters thick, but in the early days of the Eastern Front, the German panzers found that their shells simply bounced off it. In those early days of operational service, the T-34 was armed with a 76.2 millimeter high-velocity gun with three 7.62 millimeter machine guns in support. But by the time of the Manchuria offensive, the main production model was fitted with an impressive 85mm main weapon. In August 1945, it would be the turn of the Japanese to feel the force of the T-34. But this was not the only famous machine that the Soviet Union would bring to bear in the Manchuria campaign. In 1941, the Germans had also been surprised by the Soviet deployment of the M-13 rocket launcher, the so-called Katyusha. When hostilities broke out on the Eastern Front, this truck-mounted weapon soon revealed its revolutionary ability to deliver awesome firepower against a small target position. No fewer than 36 rockets could be fired from the M-13. Initially, these were 82mm solid-fuel weapons with 6.5 pounds of explosive. Range was approximately 6,000 yards with the earlier models, and this was more than enough to terrify German troops. The M-13 became known as Stalin's organ because of the eerie whining noise that the rocket made in flight. And by the time of the Manchuria campaign, an already fearsome weapon had become even more powerful. By 1945, the M-13 was fitted with just 16 rocket launchers, but each of these could fire a 132mm shell with a warhead of 40 pounds weight. Range was increased to over 9,000 yards, and the Soviet commanders knew that they had a devastating war machine at their disposal. They also had a huge number of them. Transbaikal Front alone possessed 583 of these magnificent weapons. In total, the Soviet arsenal was awesome. The rocket launchers formed a part of a guns and mortars provision totaling 28,000. Well over 5,000 tanks were brought to the Manchurian border, and the Soviets were also well supplied with air power. In the weeks prior to the beginning of the offensive, no fewer than 96 airfields were constructed around the theater of operations, and Marshal Vasilyevsky was able to call on 4,370 warplanes. Amongst them, another famous Second World War machine, the Ilyushin IL-4, a long-range bomber equally at home in roles as diverse as torpedo bombing, infantry transport, or tactical ground support. The deployment of this proven warplane can be seen as indicative of the overall strength of the hardware available to the invading force that prepared itself for battle in August 1945. Powered by twin 1,100 horsepower engines, this four-man aircraft could carry a bombload of 1,000 kilograms, or alternatively, three 500-kilogram torpedoes. It was the ideal aircraft to be used when the Soviet Union decided to give the people of Berlin their first taste of bombing from the east in 1941. And by 1945, the IL-4 would find itself used in support of the invasion on the ground. This was an important element in Soviet military thinking in the period leading up to the Manchuria campaign. Over the course of the Second World War, the Soviet Union had adopted a distinctive approach to the business of offensive warfare. In 1944, the Red Army published a volume of field regulations, which described in unprecedented detail how an operation like the Manchurian campaign should be executed. The notion of offense itself stood at the very heart of these guidelines, with the key role in any offensive action given to the infantry. All other operational units were subservient to the need for infantry advance, including armor, artillery, and air support. At first glance, this appears similar to the German Blitzkrieg approach to warfare, but the Soviet thinking did reveal one subtle difference. This can be seen in the role given to support troops behind an initial phase infantry assault. Whereas Blitzkrieg used these forces to secure occupied territory in the rear, the Soviet approach called for these troops to join in the offensive action, developing what Soviet strategists referred to simply as success. This was a bold, aggressive approach to warfare, but it required speed and surprise to prove effective in practice. The Soviet ability to achieve both these elements contributed vitally to the outcome of the Manchurian campaign. It also gives the whole offensive much of its relevance for military thinkers today. But in early August 1945, the Soviet commanders could not be completely certain of success in Manchuria. They knew that a powerful enemy awaited. The The Kwantung Army was long established in Manchuria, and its commander, General Yamada Otozo, could call on considerable resources in the event of a Soviet invasion. In eastern Manchuria, there was General Kita Saichi's 1st Area Army, comprising some 222,000 men. Covering the center and south, the 181,000 men of the 3rd Area Army, under the command of General Ushikoru Jun. In the north was stationed a smaller 4th Separate Army based at Tsitsiha. In all, another 95,000 men available to General Yamada and his Kwantung Army Command. The Japanese 34th Army of Northern Korea could also contribute two divisions, and troops stationed in regions such as southern Sakhalin and the Kuril Islands further strengthened Japanese resources, along with the army of the Manchukuon puppet state itself. In total, the Japanese could call on over 1 million men in the event of a Soviet attack. But sheer numbers alone are not always enough when it comes to battle, and the Japanese commanders knew that the Kwantung Army was far from combat ready. Many of its best troops had long since been creamed off to join the war effort in the Pacific. Many divisions lacked their nominal full complement of men, and shortages of hardware further weakened Kwantung Army strength. When battle was eventually joined, the Soviet provision of tanks, armament, and air support far exceeded that of their enemy. The statistics for armor are especially revealing. The Kwantung Army could call on 1,155 tanks. The Soviet invaders could call on 5,550. Despite this numerical deficiency, the Japanese Kwantung Army was still able to demonstrate that the Soviet Union possessed no monopoly when it came to excellent military hardware. The Japanese arsenal was small in comparison with that of their Soviet opponents, but it included weapons that had already proved themselves on the battlefields of Eastern Asia. When war broke out between China and Japan in 1937, the Chinese quickly found themselves faced with the Type 95, a light tank that proved a highly effective machine. In August 1945, the Type 95 remained an important component of the Kwantung Army armor provision. A four-man vehicle, the Type 95 was powered by a single Mitsubishi diesel engine generating 120 horsepower and a maximum speed of 45 kilometers per hour. Armament was provided by a 37mm main gun with two machine guns in support. 4.38 meters in length and just over 2 meters in width, the Type 95 proved itself to be a superb anti-infantry weapon in the battles that took place in the war with China. Though it proved less successful when faced with the might of American armor and anti-tank guns, the Type 95 could still be of value against the kind of ground offensive that the Soviet Union planned for August 1945. Japanese weaponry also revealed that the occupiers of Manchuria recognized the importance of support from the air. And although the Kwantung Air Force was less than half the size of its Soviet counterpart, it still included warplanes that could seriously hinder any ground offensive. Perhaps the most deadly of these was the Nakajima Ki-84, an aircraft whose development came late in the Second World War. A fighter plane, the Ki-84, or Hayate, could also carry a bomb load of two 250-kilogram devices. But it was as a fighter that this elegant aircraft is best remembered, especially by American bomber crews who had to deal with it in 1944 and 45. Powered by a single 1,800 horsepower engine, the Ki-84 could attain a top speed of 393 miles per hour and had a range of 1,700 kilometers. Fast and maneuverable, the Hayate was also fitted with plenty of firepower. Later models carried two 20mm cannon mounted in the nose, with two 30mm guns fitted in the wings. A warplane like this was more than capable of dealing with bombers such as the Soviet IL-4. But despite the excellence of the aircraft's design, the problem was that Japan simply could not make enough of them. only 3,382 of these fine warplanes were ever built. And it was the same with all designs of Japanese aircraft later in the war. As the Soviet attack on Manchuria loomed, General Yamada Otozo must have regretted bitterly that his Kwantung Air Force totaled just 1,800 aircraft. Marshal Vasilyevsky's force included 4,370 planes. It was without doubt a serious imbalance of resources, but General Otozo knew there were factors that favored the defending Japanese in the event of a Soviet attack. The individual Japanese soldier still possessed plenty of spirit for the fight. A fanatical loyalty to emperor and empire still flourished in the Japanese ranks, as did the desire to make the ultimate sacrifice as proof of this loyalty. The Kwantung Army were also familiar with the territory under their command, and General Yamada Otozo knew the profound geographical difficulties that faced any invading army. The Soviet Union intended to conquer some 1.5 million square kilometers of territory, an area the size of Western Europe. This sheer size alone was a powerful influence in both Soviet and Japanese planning. But it was the details of the Manchurian terrain that decisively influenced strategy when battle was eventually joined, both offensively and defensively. For any army seeking to control the lands of Manchuria, it is the central valley plains of the south that provide the key to success. As well as being the fertile heartland of the region, the central valley also enjoys the protection of some powerful natural defenses. To the west, the mountains of the Grand Hingians. To the north, the Lesser Hingians. To the east, the Eastern Highlands. All with limited avenues of approach, as the Japanese knew well. But the mountains are not the only difficulties facing any invader of Manchuria. Before the Soviet Transbaikal Front could even reach the Great Hingian Mountains, they would have to traverse the arid deserts of Inner Mongolia. In the northwest and in the east, thick forests added to the difficulties of fast-moving offensive warfare, while the riverlands of the north and northeast were surrounded by swampy marshland, which would be especially difficult to cross during the August rainy season. A successful invasion would require ingenuity and flexibility, but the Soviets approached their task with a quiet sense of confidence. We cannot be sure why it was that the Soviets decided to launch their attack on Manchuria at 0100 hours on the 9th of August 1945. But the broader political picture must surely have played a part. When the American atomic bomb was detonated over Hiroshima on the 6th of August, many in the Japanese leadership realized that the war was now lost. As Tokyo debated their response to the nuclear attack, the Soviet Union made its move. The time of planning was now past, and brilliant Soviet preparation meant that all around the Manchurian border, hundreds of thousands of troops were in position, ready for the fight, on the Transbaikal Front, on the Second Far Eastern Front, and on the First Far Eastern Front, the evening of the 8th of August 1945 saw the final preparations for what would be one of the most ambitious operations of the Second World War. Manchuria was about to become a battlefield.